This is Mount Helly Guys, where are you speaking?
That's a primary, and that's what we cut.
In the swim gear, man.
Any number of people in the water, any knowledge? Three possibles in the water. So the range area here. So a bit of a quick chat to them to make sure the range is deactivated.
We've probably got an hour offshore to do what we need to do, so it should give us plenty of time. So.
Yeah.
Okay,
let's get her out.
So far is a vessel gone down about 4 miles off Heaven's Head, and we've got three persons in the water. Fuel wise, we've got plenty of time for about an hour offshore to carry out the task.
Identify yours. Mine's identified. And we'll set the back. That door shut and secured.
They go by the call signs Lifesaver 1 and Lifesaver 2. The Northern Region Westpac Lifesaver Rescue Helicopter Service is on call 24 hours a day, every day of the year. Its primary task, saving lives. Since the service began in 1982, more than 3,500 missions have been flown, evacuating people from accidents, transferring patients to hospitals, search and rescue operations, a lifeline to those isolated by floods. For those who've used the service, there are no words or amount of thanks that can repay the debt. This is the story of just three of the many who by fate have found themselves in the most dangerous of situations. It's about what emergency services refer to as the golden hour, the 60 minutes after an accident that often determine the long-lasting effects of injuries, whether a person lives or dies. It was 11:30 on Saturday morning when the crew from the Northern Region Westpac Lifesaver Rescue Helicopter received notice a hang glider pilot was in trouble. The first reports suggested he was stuck on the side of a cliff face on the Koonyam Range behind Byron Bay.
Knowing that the terrain out to west of Mullumbimby there is fairly steep, and that's what those guys like to fly off to get the lift and so on, I was trying to think of exactly where he might be hung up, because they did say he's stuck on a cliff. Well, you know, your mind sort of leaps ahead to how are we going to get him off that cliff? What are we going to see when we get there?
What the crew saw took their breath away.
As we flew in, we came over one of the last ridge lines and we got a visual on the kite on the side of the cliff, and it was a sheer rock face. He was probably about 150 feet down, and he still had about another 300 feet to fall to the base. And we were all taken aback by how he might be staying there.
What was supposed to be a perfect day for 46-year-old Mark King had turned into one of the worst.
I had a couple of steps on the launching ramp that lessened my altitude straight away. I didn't take full advantage of the ramp because of a mistake I made at the beginning. Consequently, as I did get airborne, I was low, and I scraped a couple of saplings as I went off the bottom of the launch ramp.
150 metres above the ground, Mark's hang glider went into a nosedive. Blinded by blood from a cut on his head, it was sheer luck he got caught on some small trees on an escarpment.
I was thinking, well, I'm going to get to see my boy. I was pretty excited about that, and I knew I was going to be all right.
In radio contact with friends at the top of the cliff, Mark let them know he was alive.
And I heard the chopper. I heard the chopper straight away, a long ways away. I could hear the chopper coming. And I knew that was really good because they would have a clear shot to see where I was. That was a really big thing because the people on top of the escarpment really didn't know where I was.
And so began what was to be a long and dangerous rescue mission.
OK, mate, have you been conscious the whole time, over?
I'm just trying to,
yeah. And we'll keep up the good work,
yeah,
okay, mate?
Good chat. The height, the awkward position he was in, the unknown factor as to how long he was going to stay on the slope. So we had a look and assessed it and then stood back and let some other agencies on the ground get set up and then we worked with them to get him secure before we could even go anywhere near him.
I wasn't frightened. I wouldn't say I was frightened. There was a bit of pain involved, and that kind of keeps the mind occupied when there's a bit of pain.
Emergency services were called out en masse. At the top of the cliff, a rescue plan was devised. Ambulance officers were to abseil down the cliff face to secure Mark. The rescue helicopter would then winch him to safety. Mindful the hang glider could dislodge at any time, there was no room for error. 2.5 hours after the accident happened, the plan was executed.
By the time the boys got down to me, I was actually pretty well hanging in my harness just as if I was flying the hang glider. The first fellow down secured the hang glider, which was a great relief because then I knew that I wouldn't be going any further because I was well attached to the hang glider.
Not hanging over. Is he tied off?
Good.
The glider's tied off.
Leave him where he is.
Mate. Just leave him where he is, mate. They're on their way now.
With Mark now secured, then came the most dangerous part of the rescue.
The helicopter came back up and dropped the winch once again and hooked me in. And away we went.
Rescue crew's got the hook in hand, he's hooking himself and the res down their patient up. Waiting for the thumbs up, just give me the thumbs up now. Take the weight. Taking the weight. Clear the winch in, clear the winch in, winching. And the boat's coming out nicely.
Winching is probably the single most dangerous thing we do. The aircraft's in a position where its ability to fly away in that hover, in a high hover close to cliffs and so on, is fairly limited.
I was scared. I was scared a bit at that point. I don't know why. There was still a lot of pain involved, but it's just a little tiny cable, and I'm not used to helicopters, and I wasn't flying it either. And so I was thrilled at that point.
Dangling 45 metres below the helicopter and some 200 metres above the ground, Mark King was literally taken on the ride of his life.
The danger of them hitting things on the side of the cliff has stopped because we've now moved the aircraft away from the cliff, so they're just in mid-air. Things can still go wrong. The winch could stop or the aircraft may develop a fault or things like that. So until they actually inside the aircraft, back in seats and secured and the door closed, it's still, the pressure's there.
We had to do it fairly slowly. We had to back the helicopter away from the cliff and then fly up the valley with them some 150 feet below on the wire.
I wasn't really scared on the side of the cliff. For some reason, I knew things were going to be all right there. But when I was on the cable, I didn't really know how it was going to go.
Ever so slowly, Mark and paramedic Christine Jenkins were winched back into the helicopter. 6 hours after his accident, he was finally on his way to hospital.
I was trying to say thank you and how are you, and, you know, get me away from the door.
I felt really good when Mark finally came on board the aircraft, even though he was still in a lot of pain, but at least he was safe and sound. He's in a better spot than where he was a minute or so before. I know I had a little smile on my face that, yeah, everything went well.
If we weren't there, I guess he wouldn't have been saved.
Mark King broke his leg and arm. He's almost completely recovered.
I got a little bit unlucky in some of the air conditions, but I made a series of mistakes, and that's what happened. I mean, guys have flown up in that area. There's thousands of hours logged in that area up there, and this is really the first major sort of thing. In retrospect, I've looked back on it a couple of times and felt that along with a couple other times in my life, this was another time that the grace of God or whoever looked down on me.
This mission, while extremely difficult, is one of thousands flown by the Northern Region Lifesaver Rescue Helicopter. What amazes the crews are the circumstances that surround some accidents and people's determination to live. The far north coast of New South Wales is home to some of the best surfing breaks in Australia. While sharks are often seen in the area, attacks are rare. Surfers are aware of the risk, but it's one that's mostly disregarded as a one in a million chance. A 48-year-old school teacher from Broome's Head, south of Yamba, though, has given them cause to think again.
When I saw the blood pouring out of my leg and I realised, then it was sort of instant terror, waiting to be attacked a second time.
It's not often that the tiny town of Broome's Head, home to some 300 people, makes international news. In fact, locals say they spend a lot of time downplaying the village, believing the fewer people who know about their paradise, the better. That all changed at 4 o'clock on Sunday the 4th of February when Mark Butler went for a surf.
I went and had a look at it and my son was out there with two of his friends and it didn't look too bad and I thought, oh, yeah, I'm out there.
Mark Butler refers to Back Beach as his playground. He's been surfing here for 25 years.
So I rode my bike home, grabbed my board. By the time I got over there and paddled out, they went in. So I was out there by myself.
He surfed the break alone for 45 minutes.
I nearly went in, actually. And I thought, oh, one more. And I was paddling back out and a little bit parallel to the beach. I was about 80 or 100 metres out. And I just suddenly felt something clamp onto my leg and give it a bit of a shake. And it didn't hurt at all. And my first reaction was, oh, I've been bitten by a shark.
Scientists would later conclude he'd been attacked by a 3-metre bull whaler, an aggressive shark known to frequent inshore areas, beaches and rivers. It wasn't until he saw the blood in the water that Mark realised how badly he was hurt. Terrified of being attacked again, he started paddling to shore. The beginning of his personal battle to live.
Then when I stood up on the beach and looked at my leg and saw how much blood was coming out of the wound, I realised the seriousness of it. And, I was losing so much blood that I remember thinking, oh, I'm going to die here on the beach.
The leg rope on his surfboard saved his life, becoming a tourniquet, slowing the flow of blood from a large, gaping wound. Alone, he then staggered 250 metres across sand and rocks.
I walked along the beach to the foot of the stairway, and I don't really remember that. I remember standing at the bottom of the stairs and thinking, I can't get up here, I'm too exhausted to get up here.
Although he'd already lost some 25% of his blood, he managed to climb a steep stairway. Still ahead of him, though, was another 200-metre walk along a bush track.
I was more exhausted than I've ever been in my life, and I thought, well, I'm not going to make this. I can't make this, but I'm just going to keep going. I'll keep going until I collapse, and then I've done the best I can, you know. If I don't make it, well, at least I tried. And I reached the road, and then I started yelling as loudly as I could, help, help. And I must have been doing a good job of that, because people ran out of their houses.
With the nearest ambulance 20 minutes away and no town doctor, local residents were given the job of trying to save Mark Butler's life.
I lay down on the grass, and Jeff Towner's come over with a medical kit, and they very quickly started to try to assess what they were going to do. And as it turns out, they did a remarkable job. They were fantastic. They bandaged the wound to stop the blood, packed it with towels and tablecloths, I think, and wrapped it up and stopped the blood.
The Northern Region Lifesaver Rescue helicopter had received the call and was en route to Broome's Head.
It was just a wonderful feeling knowing that the helicopter was on its way. That was made me feel very comfortable, thinking, well, you know, this helicopter's a wonderful thing, and it's going to have me in Lismore. Well, David was telling me, you know, that when it gets here, you'll be in Lismore in 32 minutes.
Just 24 hours after his accident, news of the shark attack was beamed around the world.
48-year-old school teacher Mark Butler explained the horrific attack in detail from his hospital bed, holding his shredded board shorts. At around
life has pretty much returned to normal for Mark Butler. His scar is the talking point of many a conversation. His surfboard, a testament to his near miss, has been repaired, and he's back out in the water.
When I first started swimming, I was nervous. But the first day I went for a surf, the waves were just perfect, and sharks didn't even cross my mind. I wanted one of those waves.
While just another job for the crew of the Northern Region Rescue helicopter, the journey from Broome's Head to Lismore was one Mark Butler will never forget. With media organisations offering thousands of dollars for his story, Mark decided to accept, donating all money to the rescue helicopter service.
You know, it's a long way to anywhere by road from here. It's an hour and a half to Lismore. The helicopter's a wonderful thing, a wonderful service. I'll tell you, I appreciate it a lot more now than I ever did before.
It happened so fast. 1 minute, 16-year-old Anna Sawick was in the passenger seat of her friend's car. In a split second, metal was twisted around them, Anna's legs crushed.
I remember sort of a huge sound, and then just the silence of that, and sort of, I was in the sun, so it was hot, and I felt broken glass and sort of sticky blood.
Two cars had collided at Haters Hill behind Byron Bay. Anna had taken the brunt of the impact.
When my mother first got the call that, you know, there had been an accident, the person who called her wasn't really clear on the details. My mum just wanted to know whether I was alive, and the person didn't know. And so my mother was driving along in the car, just screaming at the top of her lungs, just be okay. You wait till I get there. Wait till I get there.
Anna was conscious, but she was pinned under the dashboard. Her left leg was shattered.
I got there pretty quickly. I think the helicopter was already there, waiting on the road. And at this stage, the rescue guys were attempting to extract Anna out of the car. But what really impressed me was the amount of care that all of the guys were showing.
I think they were trying to, you know, cut me out so that they could get the push the dash off me first. But it got to the point where I think I was in a lot of pain, and they made the call to actually just sort of pull me back out of there because they'd cut the door off and all the rest of it.
Finally free of the wreckage, paramedics had their first chance to assess Anna. Believed to be bleeding internally, they rushed to stabilise her. Staff at the Lismore Base Hospital were put on alert.
Mission Sector Wolf. Mission Sector Wolf. Mate, we're just going to go to Lismore. That's A7, and I would like to go straight back to Lismore Base Hospital. Okay.
I was in a lot of pain and needing to be, you know, needed the operation sort of straight away. So the helicopter trip, you know, meant as opposed to a 40-minute drive in an ambulance where I would be rocked around and all the rest of it, meant I could get straight there and operate on as soon as possible.
It's been 2 years since that flight in the helicopter. Three operations, 9 months on crutches, and still more time on a walking stick, and Anna Solwick says she's finally recovered.
You don't think about these things until they happen to you or to somebody close to you. But the fact is that this service is constantly saving people.
The Northern Region Westpac Lifesaver Rescue Helicopter Service is one of the region's most valuable community assets. For the thousands of people it's helped, it's priceless. But for every success, there's another story.
Any job where there's been a fatality, it touches all of us, and some of us talk about it, some of us don't. I think the hardest jobs are anything with children involved. Normally it's pretty quiet on the way home after those type of jobs.
In an area like the Northern Rivers, the helicopter service is vital. Where distances between hospitals span hundreds of kilometres and communications are limited, it's a saviour.
But while we've got a service in this area, and we're reasonably central to all those areas, that the helicopter can respond with the medical team in a quick period of time, and that's all about what they call the golden hour. So I think that golden hour might become 3 hours or something by the time you get a service down from the Gold Coast, who might not be available because they might be doing something else. Well, the nearest service to the south is probably Newcastle.
I think they all realise that, well, that helicopter's not very far away. That's a good feeling. Mobile phones don't even work out here. It's very hard to get assistance quickly.
As an individual who utilised that service, I can't thank them enough or do enough for them.
The helicopter service is a lifeline for those in need.
It's an invaluable service, and I hope that people will find a little bit of spare cash and contribute to something like this, because nobody knows when they might be affected, and it is a service to everybody in the community and a very valuable one.
But saving lives is not reward enough for the Rescue Helicopter Service. It's a charity relying on community support and donations to remain operational. Each year it needs to raise almost $1.5 million. That task is getting more difficult. At a time when government funding is limited, the service must prove it's viable. To do that, it needs the financial help of the community.
The fear that's involved if you lose somebody that you love, it's just, it can be devastating. And a service like this, which minimises that, is just, you know, what can I say? It's so good.